Well, welcome to South Granville Congregational Church. I'm so glad you're here to worship today. And I do have a few announcements, and then we'll continue on with our worship service. First of all, a couple things going on. Light club resumed today during the 9 o'clock service. If you know any families with kids, and you want them to get them to church, have them come to our 9 o'clock. Or if we get enough, we could do a light club here too. But right now, we just don't have the kids at the service. But we would love to have them. ABC Dinner returns on Monday the 3rd, first Monday in October, so bring a dish to the pass and come join us for some fellowship. And this also gives a chance for the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock to get together, along with just members from the community who just come to the dinner, which is great to have. And then next week, and during the 9 o'clock, we're going to be having a new member brought in, and that's Mommy McNeil. He was here at 11 o'clock last week, and he was actually here this week. He had gone to Canada. We didn't think he was going to be back, but next Sunday, we're going to have a membership ceremony for him during the 9 o'clock service. And then also next Sunday at 2 p.m., there's going to be a memorial service for Betty Frost's brother here at the church at 2 p.m. It's going to be more of a celebration of life. We're going to sing a few songs. I'm going to pray. I don't think I'm doing a message, but I'm not sure yet. More of a, like a time of remembrance for the family and just a time to celebrate. Then the ladies from the 9 o'clock are doing food downstairs, so don't eat a big lunch for that. There are three books on the back table. Those three books are for, there's a little one right there. Good to see you. Three books on the back table, those are from my mom's estate. I would much rather they go to you, they're all Christian books, obviously. I would much rather they go to you than to the dump. So, because I actually own most of them anyway, so. And we had our sales, we give them, tried to give them away for free. And so those are what's left. So please take them if you want them. And then the ladies' retreat coming up on October 21st to 23rd. You can go just for Saturday the 22nd. It's going to be in Silver Bay. It's put on by Hope for a Woman's Heart. They do a lot of great seminars and retreats. There's a flyer on the back bulletin board over right corner if you're interested in that. Then prayer requests. Lance Ross. She's on her prayer list, but she had a clot and ended up in the hospital. She's back up now, but just pray for Blanche. If you get a chance, give her a call, or you know, if you can stop by this year. I just found out about this morning, so I'll be getting a hold of her probably tomorrow. And then we have a prayer request for Gabriel Vladka. He's 21 years old. He just joined the Army. That is Mary Jones' nephew. And we'll be putting him on a military prayer list, but pray for Gabriel.
Ready? I wanted to have my grandson Cooper Young. He's 15 years old. He's been operating on his heart.
Cooper Young?
Cooper.
I have a couple. First, the little boy Aiden that I had asked first for last week, he does have aplastic anemia, and it is caused by leukemia. So he's 3. I saw him last night. He's doing okay. He will be heading to Boston Children's Hospital in the next couple weeks to be treated. So keep prayers for him and his family. The other young lady I prayed for, Gloria, who's pregnant, the baby is due this week. So hopefully it goes, prayers are out, it goes well with that. And praise for that. Today's my sweet son's 29th birthday.
Happy birthday.
Mine was
yesterday.
I'm 55.
Yes. 65. May lightning not strike you.
Soon, and hoping that the mass is shown. So we have to pray for that.
Okay, pray for our sister Judy. She's concerned that her cancer will be back. She's got some of the stuff. We're praying about obviously, but pray for her.
She sees the doctor on Thursday, so
we'll
know more. And we welcome Paisley this morning. Hi, Paisley.
Hi.
All right, are we ready to sing? If anybody can handle these prayer requests, it's our great Lord, isn't it? We're going to sing it through every Lord.
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the book of Genesis, chapter 35, verses 16 to 21. Genesis 35, 16 to 21.
Deaths of Rachel and Isaac. Then they journeyed from Bethel. When they were still some distance from Ephrath, Rachel went to labor, and she had hard labor. And when her labor was at its hardest, the midwife said to her, "Do not fear, for you have another son." And as her soul was departing, for she was dying, she called his name Benoni, but his father called him Benjamin. So Rachel died, and she was buried on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. And Jacob set up a pillar over her tomb. It is the pillar of Rachel's tomb, which is there to this day. Israel journeyed on and pitched his tent beyond the Tower of Eder. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Now receive your morning tithes and offerings, and this is going to be a brand new song to us today. It's called "At the Cross." It's not a new song to us, but it's new to us.
Thank you.
option. Remember your hand like those of a caring shepherd, guiding us back to our home in you, and we seek to help others experience the same loving care. So we give you this morning our tithes and our offerings to be multiplied. And we pray that we can use these gifts to reach the lost and bring them into your kingdom. These we offer in the name of the Lamb of God, Jesus the living Christ. Amen.
Now for the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, 21 years ago today, all of our lives were changed. I'm sure that each and every person here remembers what they were doing. As the memories of that day weigh heavy on our hearts, we recall with horror and renewed shock that day when airplanes flew into buildings and people perished. We remember our fear and our anger and our confusion and our sense of threat. We remember all that was lost to us that day, our sense of security, our peace, our innocence, our belief that we were safe beyond such random violence and death. Most of all, we remember those who died in New York, Washington, D.C., and Pennsylvania, their lives of promise extinguished in hatred. Father, you have taught us that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. We live in hope of the future that you hold for us and for this earth. Grant us, we pray, hope for the future generations that they may never know or inflict the horror or terror we recall this day. Strengthen our hope when it falters, and teach us to strive in all we do to realize the hope that is in your word and your witness. Loving Father, in addition to remembering and struggling with our past, many are struggling with their nows. They are dealing with sickness and injury, disease and death. Some are struggling with financial problems, some with relationships and with emotions, all types of things, Lord. We pray for and lift up before you those we love and care about. Some of us are praying for ourselves and our own situations, Lord, but you care about each and every one of our petitions. So we bring them before your throne of grace, and we thank you that you are a God who hears our prayers and who loves us. Give us your peace and comfort. Touch us with your healing hand, Lord. Provide us our daily needs. But even so, Lord, we submit to you that your grace is sufficient. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, who paid the price for our sin so that we could have everlasting life in you. Abba Father, we also want to lift up in prayer a country from which our nation was born. We pray for our allies in England as they mourn the loss of their beloved Queen. We also pray for those who have spewed such hateful things about her. May they repent of their sin and turn to you, Lord. May they turn to your Son, Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we thank you again for this day and this time we can be present together with you in your house. As we continue our worship this morning, may everything we say, think, and do be pleasing in your sight. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Here we are in our final week of this series, Death to Selfie, lessons from the book of Genesis. And in the first message in this series, we saw Jacob wrestle with God, and his name was renamed to Israel. And 2 weeks ago, we talked about Jacob returning to Bethel, which is a place of remembrance and revelation and response. And what we read in our scripture reading today takes place right after that. And of course, last week, we saw Jacob go to his uncle Laban's and seek out a wife, and he ended up working 14 years for the woman that he just, loved so much, Rachel.
So his wife Rachel, who had been barren, is actually pregnant with her second son now. And it's a male son. And they're traveling from Bethel to Ephrath, which is a little town called Bethlehem. Anybody ever heard of that place before? Yeah. And it's about an 18 to 20 mile journey, and Rachel is very pregnant. In fact, they almost make it when Rachel goes into labor. They're still a few miles out, but they're almost there. And tragically, she dies giving birth. And as she's dying, in her last breath, she says, "I want to name the baby Ben-Onami, which means son of my sorrow or son of my misfortune." She's naming him out of her pain and her grief that she'll never see her child grow up. In fact, she never even gets to hold him. You know, sometimes we ask God for things that we don't know how much it will cost us or the magnitude of the request. Rachel had, like, as I said, only two sons, Joseph, and then this baby that she died giving birth to. Is there something you've been begging God for, praying to God for, so much, you want it so badly, and he hasn't answered your prayer? Now, many times in our lives, we're giving birth to one thing, but something else is dying. You get out of school and you get to your first job, your childhood is dying, but you are being born into adulthood. You get married, your single life is dying, but you are being born into a new family. You have children, and that family of two is now dying, and you are being born into a newer, bigger family. You leave one job and start a new career, and so on. There's something new that God is giving life to, and other things that are dying. Sometimes we use the metaphor of open and closed door because we don't like to talk about dying. Well, Rachel wanted to call the baby Ben-Onai, but Jacob named him Benjamin instead. As the father, the patriarch, he was responsible for naming his children. In Luke chapter 1, Elizabeth is pregnant with John the Baptist. And after he's born, they take him to be circumcised 8 days later, as was the custom. And the relatives and the neighbors wanted to call him Zacharias after his father. But Elizabeth said, no, his name is John. And they're like, what are you talking about? Nobody in your family is named John. Why would you call him that? And they appeal to the ultimate authority, the person with the ultimate naming rights. They appeal to his father, Zacharias, who can't speak right now because he didn't believe Gabriel when he told him that Elizabeth was pregnant. And so they hand him a writing tablet. He writes out, his name is John. Now, of course, as the ultimate creator, God has given him the name John. God told Zacharias his name would be John. But as far as the neighbors and the family were concerned, Zacharias was the ultimate authority. He had the naming rights. And because he was faithful and named him what God told him to name him, John, he got a speech back. Now, Jacob didn't want his son to live with a name that meant son of sorrows or son of misfortune. He didn't want his son to always live under the stigma, under the shadow of his mother dying while giving birth to him. And Jacob didn't want to look at his son as a burden. As a matter of fact, he didn't look at his son as a burden. He looked at him as a blessing, a great blessing. And so he names him Benjamin, which means son of my right hand. The right hand is the hand of blessing. The father takes the right hand and blesses the firstborn child. Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. God tells Isaiah, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." You know, oftentimes true strength is only produced out of great sorrow. How many of you can look back at a time in your life where you went through something, where you were suffering, where you were going through some horrible time, but now you look back at it and you realize you are much stronger because of it? Don't let your past label you, loved ones. Don't let your past sin, now forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ, define you. You are reborn and you are relabeled, renamed by God. If someone has labeled you in some way outside of the Word of God, just tear that label off, because the only one who gets to name you is the one who made you. Now, there are some situations in your life that you need to rename, and there will be a blessing when you do it. It's no longer I lost my job, it's now I have opportunity. It's no longer I'm stuck behind the slowpoke, it's now I can enjoy the beauty of God and spend time with Him in prayer or listening to an audio Bible or some worship music or whatever you like to do in the peace and quiet of your car. It's no longer it's miserable and rainy and now I can't go golfing. It's now I have the opportunity to do some things I need to do around the house, clean my garage, clean my office, clean the basement, or spend quality time with my spouse. It's no longer I was a terrible husband or wife or brother or sister or father or mother or neighbor or friend who sinned. It's now I am a child of God who is forgiven and who no longer lives that type of life. I will now live a Christ-like life. I can call whatever I'm looking at right now a blessing because it's all about my perspective. In Genesis, Adam didn't create the animals, but he did get to name them. So most of the time we don't get to choose what happens to us, but we do get to choose what we call it. And whatever you call it, that becomes its name. That person in church who's difficult to love and does things that really annoy you is no longer named dislike, but patience or forgiveness. Now you can live in regret and call it what it is, okay? But wouldn't it be better if you called it what you want it to be? Today, don't let your situation dictate your destiny. If you call it what it is, it will always be that. But if you call it what God calls it, it will become something brand new. You have two choices. Call it what it is, or call it what you want. You have naming rights. The situation might not change, but you give it a new name and you can have a new outlook about it. Now, it's true that some things are really difficult, if not almost impossible, to get past simply by renaming them. Our scripture reading is a good example. Okay, Rachel, the woman Jacob loved, that he with all his heart, she's gone. She's dead. She died. Sometimes you have to start with Ben-Oni before you get to Benjamin. If someone has hurt you deeply, if they have betrayed you, it's okay to name it for that sorrow, and out of that strength can arise. Call it what you want, but it doesn't take any faith to call it what you think it is. It's time to change some birth certificates in your life. There are some things that you're going through right now that are truly sorrowful, but that bad situation does not define you. On September 8th, 2007, a very young pastor, Levi Lusco, and his wife welcomed into the world a new baby daughter, Wendy. And then in 2012, on December 20th, while they were wrapping presents, Wendy died unexpectedly from an asthma attack in her father's arms. That's probably the worst possible thing that could happen to someone that I could think of. But Levi and his wife, they don't call it the day when you die. They call it the day when you went to heaven. Because her life is now over. She is in heaven with Jesus. In our scripture reading today in verse 20, it says, and Jacob set up a pillar over her tomb. It is the pillar of Rachel's tomb, which is there to this day. And then it continues and said, Israel journeyed on, pitched his tent beyond the Tower of Edom. Scripture uses Jacob's new name given to him by God, Israel, to remind him that he is no longer the deceiver, Jacob the deceiver, but the man who has striven with God. He has moved on with some losses and a broken heart. He has moved on without the one that he loved, that he spent most of his good years for and with. But he still moved on. Don't put a label on your life or on yourself and think that because you've done certain things in your past, that you are beyond redemption or moving on. Don't label your life on what you've lost. You may have to move forward with a limp like Jacob did after wrestling with God, but you can move on. It's not too late. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And as we draw closer to Jesus' return, and love knows I believe it is ever so close, we're going to talk about this starting in October. I remind you what Jesus said in Revelation chapter 2. He said, therefore repent. If not, I will come to you soon to war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna. And I will give him a white stone with a, what's that say, church? With a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. All those in favor of the new name from Jesus? And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen.
Any questions or comments today? Yes.
The second son, where Rachel died, was Benjamin. Could you remind me who the first son
Joseph.
Was? Joseph, of course.
Yes.
Okay.
Joseph, who we see later, taken, sold by his brothers, and ends up being like second in command in Egypt.
So wait a minute. Where did those other brothers come from? I don't remember.
They came from his wife,
his
other wife, right?
Oh, Leah.
Leah, and then from some of the maid servants as well.
So they were his half-brothers.
Yeah.
I wonder if they were with him.
Yeah. Family dynamics. There's nothing clean about it in the Bible, that's for sure. You think your situation is unique. It's not.
No.
Right? But God uses these people, doesn't he? I mean, they are the 12 tribes of Israel. Both kids. Anybody else? All right, if I can have the worship team come back up.
Would you stand and join us if you're able as we close with open the eyes of my heart?
Open the eyes of my heart.
your past or sin define who you are. Don't let the opinions of the world define you. You have a choice. Let your past define you, or let God's grace define you. Let the power of the Lord lift you, re-energize you, and redefine who you are. You are a child of God.